Big breakthrough over here in Korea. We just got cherry Coke Zero for the first
Oh,
time.
wow.
Huge news. Huge if true, and it's true.
Do you guys have like the freestyle machines over there, or?
No, we don't actually.
Damn.
I guess unfortunately. Yeah, unfortunately. That's the kind of shit that makes me realize how long I've been gone. Is like I don't think I've ever used a fucking Coke freestyle machine in my life. I've heard about them. I've heard about them like on podcasts, like the Doughboys or whatever. People, I've heard tale of Coke freestyle machines,
I'm
but
trying to think of, I mean, the one bummer is
no.
there's like freestyle machines in gas stations where, you can add like cherry vanilla, like, whatever the fuck to your fountain beverage. But there's also one where you can add like energy, just some sort of energy sauce to whatever you're drinking. So you just earn whatever you're fucking drinking into an energy drink, which is very nice. They don't have that in the movie theaters, unfortunately, and I could have used it a few weeks ago. The last time I used a freestyle machine, because I don't know if it's been fucking hot over there in Korea.
It
It
has.
has, yeah, fuck it. Well, yeah, it's been hot as shit over here. So I had hit up a friend, and I was just like, "Yeah, hey, what's the longest fucking movie that's in theaters right now? Find it, I'll buy tickets." And she's like, "Some movie called Horizon," and I was like, "Sold. I think it's that shitty Kevin Costner movie." And are you aware of Horizon?
I'm
Wait, are
not.
you aware
I
of
mean it.
Horizon, an American Saga, Chapter One?
Jesus. I mean I am now. I'm looking
3 hours
did he
long.
direct? Ooh, it's got some rough ratings right off the bat here.
The sequel comes out in August.
Kevin Costner's doing these kind of movies again? What the
He just
fuck?
got Yellowstone pilled to hell. He's like, yeah, everyone loves fucking Western shit, so I'm gonna make a fucking Western. He's just making his Western avatar.
He should have like learned he should have I thought he would have maybe learned his lesson. I guess that's like a million years ago now, but like in the 90s he made a 3 hour long
$300 million.
Wyatt Earp
Oh, wait, the
movie.
Wyatt Earp movie.
Well, after Waterworld, which was like the big, popular disaster or whatever, which I shouldn't say I went back to it, but like I watched it for the first time as an adult like a couple of years ago on the podcast actually. I'm a little bit of a Waterworld truther. It's not nearly as bad as people hyped it up to be. It's really just more of a like meh, yeah, I get why that lost money. Like they put a ton, way too much money into it, but like, it's not like a terrible
Yeah,
movie.
it's just one of Kevin Costner's epics, like the fucking Postman or fucking.
But like I think all of those are maybe worse than Waterworld. And like but he also made so he made like that 3 hour long Wyatt Earp like vanity project. But they like came out like the same year as Tombstone, which was like, the Kurt Russell Wyatt Earp movie, which is like also like is a cheesy ass movie, but it's like fun and it's got, Val Kilmer being like cool ass what's his face?
Oh yeah, Doc Holliday, I think, or
That's right.
it's. I mean, the '90s, they just love to put out two different studios would love to just put out two different of the same fucking movie.
Your Volcano and Dante's Peak. Your what was the? There were
Oh, there
two
was
like
Armageddon
Meteor
and Deep Impact.
and Deep Impact, right?
I'm trying to think. Fucking, I feel like there was two fucking There's two weather movies, like there was Day After Tomorrow and like some other one.
Oh yeah. I mean,
They just
wasn't Twister
I mean
or
shit, like Mortal Kombat and fucking Street Fighter the movie came out within like 6 months of each other.
that's true, yeah.
But yeah, oh, I mean shit, yeah, 95 too, going back to it. Or no, I think the net was in 96, or maybe it was 95. But yeah, right around the same time as we had Hackers.
Hackers and The Net were very close, yeah. You get your Speed and your Speed 2. Those were only a couple of years apart.
And then, yeah, just the wild summer that fucking just back to 95, since I'm prepping for the next life, the next iteration of Board to Life. Board to Life 95. But yeah, like fucking Ice-T being in both fucking Giant Mnemonic and Tank Girl in the same year.
I forget what year it is, but it's got to be near that movie I was just talking about the other day that I probably will end up doing for this podcast at some point. Surviving the Game.
Oh, yeah. I feel like that was like that movie, some kind of movie that I almost rented at the video store a bunch of times, but then didn't.
I only like, you know, found it like, you know, probably like less than 10 years ago, and it was like through like bad movie podcasts or whatever, but that's a banger. It's got like every grizzled like old white guy character actor who has always seemed like 60 years old even when they were like 20.
Hell yeah.
In it, and they're all hunting homeless Ice-T for sport.
Yeah, this is definitely coming together.
It's very problematic. It's like Powers Booth, Gary Busey, F. Murray Abraham. It's like the cast is just stacked with those kind of grizzled character actor guys.
I mean, that was a fucking all. I mean, shit. You know, talk about making two of the same movie. We had two of the same actor walking around at the same fucking time in Nick Nolte and Gary Busey.
Right,
just two
right.
Fucking bedraggled fucking blonde fucking mix just running around just kind of being drunk and fucking pissed in movies.
That does feel like one of those things of like people of a certain age will only get that kind of reference, because like when you look back on it like objectively, they're really not that much the same. But like,
I don't know.
It makes so much
sense.
I know exactly what you're saying. Like, I thought the same thing growing up. I was like, oh, yeah, I always confuse those guys together. But then, like, growing up more, I'm like, man, they're really kind of pretty different. Like,
well, it's the same way with me and fucking, I was talking about it somewhere with fucking Patrick Swayze and Kurt Russell. I know they're completely different people, but.
They got similar swagger. I can
yeah, they're
see
just
that.
Sort of yeah. Short, serious boy, like brunettes, I guess. And, you know, yeah. Kurt Russell doesn't squint as much, but he can.
He can squint when he needs
to. Yeah.
So.
Especially if he's trying to see something with the eye patch on. Because, yes, Kurt Russell was Snake Plissken, not Patrick Swayze. Would have been different energy.
Oh, yeah. Very different. All right. Yeah, let me just officialize this, and we'll get going. I know. I said that like 10 minutes ago. Sorry if I'm a little slow. I got an hour of sleep, so that's what's gonna make this fun.
Hell yeah!
Two other people we can confuse together: Ben Carson and Herman Cain. I just see that on my phone here. Anyway,
I don't know. I think I might have to call you in for that one. They're very much different guys. One guy got played by Mike Tyson in a very Funny or Die sketch, and one did.
Somebody on the Discord confused them together, and I was like, I've confused them together too, but like as I was confusing them together, I knew I was doing it, because it was basically me trying to figure out which one of them died of COVID.
That was Kane.
I know who they are. They're very distinct. Yeah. I'm admitting to a time. I mean, this is all like documented. It's on the air. But yeah, they're very different guys. I mean, you just got to remember 999, and then like If These Hands Could Eat Pussy is Ben Carson.
I mean, I guess that's a good skill for fucking a surgeon to have. I actually know a wrestler that fucking got brain surgery by Ben Carson when he was a baby.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so he had a metal plate in his head, which we always, you know, were like, yeah, don't headbutt him, ever. Just Ben Carson.
All right, now I'm going to put a metal plate in your head, and it's going to be very interesting for you. You're going to get a lot of hassle and clapback at the airports after 9/11 happens, which I already know about for some reason, even though it's 1986.
I saw that Ben Carson was trending on Twitter, so I was like, what's this about? And then, you know, I quickly realized it was a bunch of people, Trump people, saying, like, he's the guy. He should be the VP. He's perfect. He's black. So they were just, like, playing the ID poll game. Like, and he's super Christian. Because, like, and then the more I thought about it, I was like, Ben Carson is kind of the perfect VP for Trump in a weird way. For the reasons they're saying.
He could be like just like plus, a more flavorless Pence, or like Pence with less teeth.
He's just black. He's black Pence with gifted hands is how I put it. I was like, because he's got the like extreme, like really, really believes in the evangelical thing going, which Pence definitely had. But he's also he's dull, and he's like, he doesn't seek like the limelight necessarily, which is like, to me, seems key for anyone that's going to be Trump's, you know, running.
How do you be dull not seeking the limelight and running for president at the same time, though?
Vice president. Well,
he was running for president.
Right. Like, yes, you're right. But that means
did he have a therapist that was like, you should put yourself out there more? And he's like, all right, I have just the idea.
That's what made him so funny, though. Exactly. And like, and I was saying, like, I hope to God this happens just for the sake of it will increase the amount of like Felix Biermann, Ben Carson impersonations.
The vice presidential debate between him and Kamala would be
Kamala. That's exactly what I said. I was like, he's got the all natural zanned out vibe. She's got the inorganic chemical zanned out vibe. So it would just be like two zanned out, tokenized candidates like talking gibberish at each other.
What if they just gave him like a fat rail though? And you know, he's a and then he just went Wayne Brady on like Chappelle show mode. He's like, oh, you thought I was Ben Carson? Little Ben Carson. Nah, this fucking Ben fucking pussy eating hands Carson.
And we know Kamala can like, we just saw that video she did with I don't even know who that lady is, but like, I don't know if you saw that either. Like, there's just like that stupid like short clip of her and this other black lady like just kind of faux ghetto speaking at each other. She's like, girl, you know I ain't trying to play like that. You know, she's like saying shit like that. It was so snip snapping her fingers and shit. It was so funny. So yeah, I would love to see a Ben Carson Kamala showdown.
Yes.
It's what we deserve and what we probably won't get. So I'm not gonna get my hopes up.
They somehow Freaky Friday each other, shaking hands before the debate in the back.
And somehow, no, it just doesn't make any difference to anything. Like, it's just the same thing.
Kamala's in Ben's body, like, trying to, like, talk about the coconut tree. And he's like, wow, you really can't raise your voice at all. Huh, this is interesting.
All right. Now, this time, I'm serious about actually really, truly starting the show. Here we go.
He walked out in the gray light and stood, and he saw for a brief moment the absolute truth of the world. The cold, relentless circling of the intestate earth. Darkness implacable. the blind dogs of the sun in their running, the crushing black vacuum of the universe, and somewhere 200 animals trembling like ground foxes in their cover. Borrowed time and borrowed world and borrowed eyes with which to sorrow it. And lo, for the earth was empty of form, and void, and darkness was all over the face of the deep, and we said, look at that fucker dance.
Welcome to Heat Death of the Universe, the most photographed barn cast in America, photographed by photographers taking photographs of the most photographed barn cast in America, by photographers taking photographs of photographers taking photographs of the most photographs barn cast in America, ad infinitum, ad nauseum, ad busterism, ad bustin. A nut upon the very photog itself. It is 7:32 a.m. First track of the first Velvet Underground album, July 14th, Korea Standard Time, Year of Our Lord 2024. This is the sound of Josh's voice announcing Josh's voice. I look to my Californian direction and see a blank slate for Timothy Grizzly Man Treadwell Buckner is not there. Oh, but who do I see further westward where the course of empire shucks and jives away? It's Alex Worldwide Kellar making his Three Timers Club appearance on this very podcast.
That's right. Get out your Canon action cameras and photograph this Triple Crown winner right here. Though, did you say westward?
I did.
So I'm... All right, so you just went all the way west from California, I guess.
No, I'm just retarded, and I I mean... Beep, scratch that, turn around. I'm regardedly sleepy. Of course, east, going east, even from the far east over here in South Koreatown. Yeah, I think maybe I just wanted to reference something with the word westward, and I got carried away. I don't know.
I don't know. I'm kind of a north pilled these days. Randomly decided to, well, it wasn't random, something inspired it, but yeah, I got off a bunch of the social media apps. I just deleted Twitter and Instagram and shit off my phone.
Smart move.
And then I ran out of this one manga I was reading because I realized I hadn't picked up one fucking volume or whatever. So then I went to my library, and yeah, I've now read almost all of the Fist of the North Star manga, and pat myself on the back there for being, oh, fuck, shit. It's got cigarette ash, but on my fucking open thigh, but it's all good. But yeah, either way, so yeah, I've just been reading a lot of Fist of the North Star. Much better than either movie made of those things. But yes, I am to the east of the not here ass Tim Buckner.
I mean, if you're one of us suckers that believes that we live on a spherical Earth, you know.
Then yeah, I'm 100% to the west.
Anyway, you want it to be, really.
Yeah, it's 5 o'clock somewhere.
You're One Piece guy, though, right? Aren't there like 10 million issues of that? Have you read all of them?
Well, I own them up to volume 105, and there's like generally about like 9 to 12 chapters in any given volume. So you can do the math there, but I think it's up to like 1120 chapter count, and then like episodes of the anime, they're at like, I think, 1100 or 10.
It's past 1,000.
Oh,
right?
Yeah, it's they're like 100 past 1,000.
Oh, okay.
But, I mean, yeah, fucking, yeah, I don't know, I just got unemployed last year for a spell, and then just randomly decided, all right, well, I'm going to read slash watch One Piece. So I did that. And now I'm just week to week like a sucker.
Yeah, friend of the show, former co-host of the show, Jason, big fan, big One Piece guy, and he did that shit even without being unemployed somehow.
I mean, if you got time in front of a computer screen, you can definitely just kill like 10 chapters in like a nice half hour, 45 minutes.
I've got another friend who, like, he's much better at Korean than either Jason or I, who's read the whole goddamn thing in Korean, which is pretty impressive.
Oh, wow.
I would say. Yeah.
I want to say one of the articles you sent me might have been in Korean.
it is. It automatically translated to English on a Chrome, or at least on my phone it did.
iOS for the iPhone, it was like, yeah, this is in Korean. And I was like, well, I guess I got to learn Korean, buddy.
I don't know if we're going to get to that one anyway. And mostly that one was just about the hilarity of the headline, but we'll see.
Yeah.
There's a lot of bullshit on the plate here. We'll see how much we actually get to, but I suppose we should start off with what I guess sadly is like maybe the biggest news of the day, but it's also some of the primest shit we're ever gonna get from our dear leader, Mr. Joseph Robinette Biden. It almost feels like so late to the game to even bring up, but you know, how do you not mention it, right? Like, first of all, this is a weird fact of this whole thing to me, is that they were hyping up this press conference. They're like, Joe Biden is going to do a press conference. They're acting like this, it's in itself, is a big deal. And of course, it's all like, it's all damage control for the fucking disastrous debate where suddenly a bunch of people realize that Joe Biden's missing half his brain and has been for like 5 years. Like, oh shit, we just noticed yesterday because he looked bad on the TV, unlike all the other times he looked just as fucking bad on television. But somehow this is worse. You know, whatever, we can get conspiratorial about it. Maybe it's all just like the party, like cannibalizing itself, turning in on itself, strategically losing, whatever. But I thought it was hilarious that his supporters, not his detractors, people that like Biden, including his press secretary, that god awful lady, and other people, we're saying he's gonna do his big boy press conference. Did you hear this shit? They were literally calling it his big boy press conference.
No, but I gotta say I had to like go out to Toledo away from me to go grab like a fucking mattress and some other shit from my mom's place, and she let me borrow her van to come back, and so we're just traded cars. Her van has satellite radio, which is set to fucking CNN, like whatever their satellite radio feed is. And it has not, when I've been listening late night when I'm like driving to or from work or whatever, I don't know, CNN sounds pretty poisoned against the guy, which is kind of interesting.
It is. It's like, it's both weird and not, I guess, which is like almost kind of like sums up all of this bullshit. But like, because, like, you can, like, easily construct a narrative in your head of, like, why, like, I don't know. It's obvious to me that Democrats, at least, and I think probably to some extent as well, both parties, ultimately don't really care if they lose or not as much as they, you know, they take all these certain actions. There's all this drama showing that they want to win the presidency and they want to take control of whatever house of, the legislative branch. But like, either way, as long as the checks keep rolling in.
Yeah, they can just fundraise on it. So who gives a shit?
Yeah, you can fundraise on, like, you know, being the resistance, or you can fundraise on being maintaining your dominance. It's basically as simple as that. But, like, they were literally calling this thing his big boy. I'm not exactly, I mean, it sounds like I'm making this up, at least it sounds like it to me. Like, I thought it, I nothing should shock me, and I guess it nothing really does, but, like, I was still a little bit taken back by the fact that, like, his press secretary was like, well, you know, he's about to have his big boy conference coming up. And, like, she did kind of, like, annoying smile, like, oh, it's funny that we're saying big boy, but it's like, you're really condescending to this, like, senile old man by calling it this. But anyway, so we had his big boy fucking press conference, which was, like, disastrous. So, like, within one day, we got two of, like, what is going to go down in his history is one of, and a man who is so full of classic gaffes as Biden. I think two of his most classic gaffes happened in one day, and it was supposed to be on the day that he tries to, like, redeem himself and prove himself to everybody is like, hey, he can say sentences, he can use words properly.
Is this where he called Kamala fucking Vice President Donald Trump?
Yes, that was the big one,
folks. Kamala has a great set of shoulders, just like me. It's an easy mistake to make, you know. Blind squirrels and acorns. You know, sometimes the blind squirrel finds the acorn.
One of the best parts about it was there was a static shot on Tony Blinken and Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin and, like, whatever, like, all the big heavy hitters. They're all sitting next to each other in the front row, and it's like it shows them at the moment where he says, I chose Vice President Trump because she's a great leader. I mean, that's almost verbatim what he said. I'm barely exaggerating. He did misgender Trump, or however you want to say it. I mean, or
Carmella, just say, my beautiful wife, Dr. Carmella Soprano Trump Biden.
And you just see them, like suppressing, like, full body, like, wincing. Which was, there was a similar thing, like, probably, like, years ago now, but when Biden had just met with Xi Jinping, and he had just left Washington, like, an hour before this other press conference. And they're like, Mr. President, would you still say that Mr. Xi is a dictator? And he's like, well, yeah, he's a fucking dictator. And, like, they had the camera trained on Tony Blinken's face. And you just see this, like, he, like, couldn't suppress it. He just looked, like, pained. I think when we talked about this on the podcast, Tim and I compared it to that moment where Ralph on The Simpsons in slow motion, you can see his heart rip in half.
Yeah,
it's kind of a similar thing. Like, slow it down, you see Tony Blinken's, like, brain just, like, explode because Joe Biden has just deeply insulted the leader of the most powerful country on earth or whatever. But anyway, so yeah, he called his vice president his number one opponent, but, you know, whatever, no big deal. That was also literally the first thing he said. I think that was the first answer to the first question of the whole thing. So they can't, like, these sad people who are, like, still trying to defend Biden as being competent.
Maybe Biden was having a flashback to the 2019 into 2020 primaries when, you know, Kamala was his most feared opponent. What with all the, you know, fucking states she won, and, you know,
that little girl was me. Yeah, she went after him hard, and then later had a total meltdown. See episode 2 of this podcast where we analyze that very meltdown where she's like, now I'm Joe's running mate. Yes, I know I called him a racist in that debate 2 weeks ago, but now we're best friends. It was just a debate. It was a debate. It's all fake, folks. But yeah, anyway. But then the other one was he was introducing Zelensky, I believe, at the NATO summit, you know, celebrating 75 years of defensively defending our NATO-ness. And he introduced President Zelensky as President Putin. And he did actually, unlike with the Trump-Kamala mix-up, he took like a five-second beat and had his eyes like shot open wide. He was like, oh, Putin, I mean, we're going to beat Putin. I'm not introducing Putin.
I don't think Putin's fucking hot. I don't want to suck Putin's fucking dick. Fuck you. What? You're gay for thinking that.
Exactly. Yeah.
I don't want him to ride me around like a little like, fucking pony with fucking goddamn rider thing in my fucking mouth. Like, you know, that's not what I want. That's what you want. Because you're gay, lady.
That's... it's kind of the perfect way to describe, yeah, like, he just, yeah, he, yeah, I'm not gay, you're the gay one, you're thinking all the gay thoughts that are in my head type objections there on Biden's part. He also went off on, like, I mean, there were, like, a bunch of things, but, you know, I think the only other one I can remember off the top of my head, at least right now, is that he said... the question was like something about his mental fitness, and he just went on like this fucking rambling fucking maze of slurred words and maybe slurs as well, and ended up at, I'm going to bring Korea and Japan back together again. It's like,
that's
like, I mean, okay, I understand what he was trying to say. He was trying to say something like, I'm going to like help the relations between these two countries.
But the last time they were together, it was because Japan was being a dick.
A bit of a settler colonial situation. A little reminiscent of another one perhaps taking place as we speak on Biden's dime and time. But yeah, I saw a pretty good gif that was just like Biden look with that like deer in headlights look, but then it's just like got the big imperial Japan sun like shining out from Korea, like, but like circling in behind him. Yeah. And then people all freaked out because George Clooney wrote some fucking op-ed that was basically, I love Joe Biden, but he needs to go away now.
He's ugly old, not hot old like me.
It had like more effect on the general public than 5 years of watching Joe Biden's brain melt out of his ears in real time and just everyone being in denial about it. And funny thing about it too, about all this shit, is that like Trump and a lot of the people on the right are actually in a weird roundabout way coming to Biden's defense for obvious reasons. They want him to stay,
yeah,
as the nominee because he's obviously the easiest to beat in their minds.
I mean, that's why I think,
which is another funny thing for like these in, oh, go ahead.
Fucking, yeah. I mean, yeah, that's like going back to the whole Democrats, like trying to dump him thing. I think that, you know, a few people are going to be silent and a few people are going to like register some like, you know, complaint and be like, I think, because at the end of the, but then they're just going to let him fucking run, because if he wins, it's not like Biden has any shooters that from beyond the grave are going to fuck them over for having spoken against him. And if he loses, they can be like, well, we told you so. And fucking da da da. And then they can just fundraise, you know, resisting Trump for fucking 4 years and then scaremonger about, right, fucking DeSantis or Tom Cotton or whoever the fuck. Or the dog, one of the many dog killer ladies in the party.
It's really why, I mean, there's many reasons why a lot of this shit doesn't matter, but that's one of them is like, so like the squad is basically like the one they're coming to more of a defense of Biden than like other people. And but just on like, and like Bernie, oh god, it's so sad. But also I guess not surprising.
It's but fucking crazy. Just to think what has happened in like the last 4 or 5 years. Like, and where people are
Bernie was completely cucked in 2020 for fucking Joe Biden, but like it still is slightly alarming when I see the way like he said something to the effect of like, oh, we just saw him the other day. He sounded great. Joe looks great. He's fine. Well, he's great. He's doing great.
Because he can do.
It's like, dude, some of the more like milquetoast fucking Dems are telling him he needs to get the fuck out, and like, but Bernie Sanders and Ilhan Omar are like, we've got his back. He's our candidate. You know, AOC's out there just like, he is the one we chose. Therefore, he's good and he's the one. I know we all said we're really against this genocide stuff, which let's pretend Joe has nothing to do with
or the children in cages at the border,
totally behind Joe 100%. But also remember, we're against genocide 100%. This is not contradictory. This does not cancel. In fact, it just cancels things out perfectly to where we break even. Look.
I mean, I've said it a million times, but I hate that all of AOC's longtime fucking, whether it's like weird post-left fucking freaks or just right-wing dickheads or anyone, I hate how correct they all were about AOC. I really do. Like, and I'll admit it, yeah, they were right. I mean, I wasn't like a fucking cheerleader or anything, but I was like, I don't know, seems like you could probably be doing something more useful than just posting about how much he sucks every day. Seems like a weird fixation.
Yeah.
But then in hindsight, it's like, well, what else were they going to fucking do? And look at where she is now. So, fuck.
But the people coming from the right are like, their complaints about her are insane and stupid and are completely
wrong.
Yeah,
but
wrong,
also,
like,
she's
an insane socialist. She's a Marxist. Like, and like the complaints that I have about AOC are for totally different.
Yeah, but people on the right also say that she's either power hungry or just dumb as fuck, or some pleasant mix of the two. And because
you're right.
It's you know, I don't know. Like I said, like sometimes people can be correct for the wrong reasons, and sometimes they're right on the money, and doesn't mean the money doesn't sting. Because, fucking, goddamn, like, that shit. Because, yeah, it was years watching people just be like, barf, AOC. And then, like, all of a sudden, it's like, not all of a sudden, like, she was definitely giving hints. But, yeah, like, it's just like, yeah, fuck her. Fuck it all. I'm, at this stage of the game, I'm honestly just kind of like, if some organization comes along that wants to do something cool, cool. But I don't think that organization's coming along until things get a lot shittier for everyone, so just kind of survive, wait, and see.
And for the time being, that those organizations are all very small-time, just basically like communist cranks who I love and support, but like, you know, they're like. If you think the Green Party's not popular enough, like, you look at these other parties and, like, yeah, they've got, like, no chance in hell. But yeah, I've definitely been on the squad is essentially shit for years now. But,
I mean, Tlaib's all right still, isn't she?
She's the best of all of them, but, like, she's still kind of sucks in some ways.
Where was she at with the whole Chinese electric car tariff thing? Because I'm assuming she's, like, riding for Detroit-ish.
Actually, I had no idea about that. I just know that she made some big speech a few months ago, because this was, like... She had, like, you know, like, made, like, her brave kind of stance about Palestine, but then, like, a couple, like, months into that, or weeks even, maybe, she went on this whole tear about, like, very right-wing-esque take on Syria, which was not cool at all, which I guess, like, only fucking, you know, dorks like me who, like, read the gray zone or whatever even noticed.
I gotta be honest, I am very ignorant on Syria. I still am. Even after fucking Palestine popped off this last time, I was like, maybe, and then I was like, you know what? No. At the end of the day, I'm sure we fund someone, and so I'm going to just vaguely root for whoever we're not funding, but I don't think anyone's good there, and incidentally, yeah, that's not us giving billions of dollars a year to fucking some dog shit place that's just murdering people. But that's also me showing ass. I don't know.
I mean, I'm definitely not an expert about anything, but I do know that the U.S. is... definitely on the wrong side of things, Syria-wise. Like, essentially, the U.S.'s role in Syria is, like, A, we've been occupying, like, a third of the land for years and years and years now, and it happens to be the most, like, oil-rich land, and we are just literally stealing oil from Syria and, like, shipping it through Iraq. And the other thing is that the people we're giving guns and money to in Syria happen to be ISIS and Al-Qaeda. And we're like, hey, go kill some of the other people we're not so fond of. Yeah, it's just, it's more of that typical, like, chessboard, great powers, shit, proxy war type stuff. It's really horrible and just ends up, like, getting a lot of people killed.
So Assad
for no
good?
Reason. It's bad. It's bad.
All right,
folks.
So Assad bad.
And Rashida Tlaib, who is, I would say, like, if there's any, like, one last hope in our legislative branch, it's maybe her, I guess. But even she was, you know, had a pretty rough take on Syria. But
well, I mean, anyone from the region, there's going to be regional fucking... I mean, I remember I saw something around, like, October or November of last year where it was, like, just, like, some interview clip with fucking Gaddafi where he's like, Israelis and Palestinians are so annoying. And it's just like, well, yeah. I mean, I guess maybe if you're a neighbor or something, yeah, you're just tired of it. But... because, yeah, I mean, even going, yeah, I mean, shit. Yeah, every region has their, like, inter-ethnic, you know, fucking just grievances and this and that.
There are some instances where geopolitics are very complicated, and then there are instances where they're not, and where people say that they are. Like, the Israel-Palestine
very
thing
easy.
Is not complicated. It's very easy. But there are other dynamics going on, like you're saying, that... maybe are a little more complicated, yeah. I mean, I guess, speaking of all that, speaking of hell on earth in the Middle East region of the world, because I'm pretty sure that's all I have to say about what the fuck Biden's been doing lately, although, I mean, there's always so much, but actually... there's one of the funniest reactions I saw to all this Biden shit was I'm looking for it here. Okay, well, one of the things was that apparently, like, 8 physicians have, like, come and gone in, like, a very short amount of time, and so there's a lot of there's this speculation that Biden's issues that he's got Louis body dementia, the same thing that
Louis C.K. has,
old Robin Williams.
Oh,
the same thing that Louis C.K. has. It makes you jerk off in front of people.
He's like, this is healing. This is self care. I'm the president of the United States. Let me self care.
It literally was the thing, though, that I'm pretty sure caused Robin Williams to take his life. Apparently, it's possibly what's going on with Biden or some other form of like Parkinson's disease. But then I saw this pundit whose name I don't think I've ever said on this podcast, and I'm loath to even say it now, but who gives a shit? because this podcast is not big enough to care, really, and also cares. But David Pac-Man, I like to call him David Hackman. He made some stupid video that was just like, he's just a fucking like lib who, you know, maybe back in 2019, like he could pass himself off as a leftist or something. But I don't know. I don't even know that much about him other than he just seems really annoying and he has bad takes. But this video he made was him saying like, so President Biden has Parkinson's. If it turns out to be true, I don't care. Who cares? Doesn't change my vote whatsoever. And he's like saying it like it's just like strong stance, like he's taking such a strong position. Like,
I mean, to be fair,
and obviously with
Michael J. Fucking Fox, you know, he had Parkinson's, and I think he cranked out a few more seasons of Spin City. Basically, the same thing as being president of the United States.
Same thing as being, yeah. It is. It's a real Spin City over there in D.C.
Yeah. That's why someone tried to establish a no spin zone, and they were canceled for it.
Fuck it, we'll do it live. No, it's just like, you know, I mean, I guess like obviously what's like hypocritical and funny about shit like that is that like it just sounds so much like any like MAGA like ride or die like allegiance, like unconditional allegiance, I feel like always makes you look kind of stupid. I mean, I guess maybe there's certain things I would pledge unconditional allegiance to. I'm not sure what they are, but maybe there's something, but definitely not any politician.
Have you heard about this series of books called One Piece? That's a good one. You could place on it. Eikichi or Eikichi Oda? Yeah. I will pledge allegiance to Oda. What the hell?
Yeah, unconditionally. For some reason, I thought you were going to say, have you heard about this book called Dianetics? But,
have you heard about this guy, Assad? Yes, on all the allegiance. But no. Actually, hold up one second. Then, I'm going to go re-up my iced coffee here real quick. Be right back.
Yeah, sure. What's up?
Crazy breaking news. Trump
really?
Just got shot.
Are you serious? What the fuck? This is the greatest
rally.
Thing. That's ever happened on the podcast. I just Googled Trump shot, and oh boy, are you not joshing me.
Everyone behind him doesn't even move. They're just sitting there like the fucking Secret Service are dogpiling on him, and these hogs are just sitting there just like, oh, huh.
Shots fired at Trump rally. You know what the first thing that just popped to my mind reading this headline is from C-SPAN? Is they're doing the same shit that they do to the fucking Palestinians to Trump right now. They're using like the passive voice like, oh, an explosion happened at the refugee camp. A bullet happened to be in Trump's ear.
Fucking God damn. I mean, I'm not going to say who, but the person that just told me just now is like, I think it's pretty convenient that it only caught him in the ear. Fucking, you know.
It's a false flag
to gain sympathy. Only, you know, fucking, what's his name? George Wallace. He got shot. He ended up in a fucking wheelchair. You know, caught some sympathy votes off of that. Trump was like, "What? We have very good snipers, right? The best. All right. How about just my ear? Just the top of my ear. Just take a little off the top.
You know, I saw something the other day that I'm surprised I had never seen before, which was that, like, actually, it felt so familiar. Maybe I had seen it before. I just hadn't thought about it for forever. But, like, I guess, like, not that long after Reagan got shot, he was giving a speech and a balloon popped in the audience. Yeah. And he stopped for a second. And this is like people like to cite this as like how fucking cool and calm and collected. And to be fair, it is kind of a baller move what he did. As much as I loathe to say anything positive about Ronald fucking Reagan,
but yeah.
The balloon pops and like everyone kind of like you know you hear everyone inhale like, and he just goes, "You missed me." And then he just like, keeps going on with his speech. I think maybe if there's a false flag angle to this, maybe Trump had just seen that video on YouTube or something and was like, I got to recreate that moment somehow. Like, I got to be cool and calm when I get shot in the ear. Oh, damn. This is definitely by far the most interesting breaking news we've had in real time on this very show. I don't see anything about ear though, although I'm not looking that hard. I'm still just like scrolling headlines, but it's like rushes him off stage after popping noises heard. That was like 8 minutes ago, NBC. You know, the other funny thing about Google here is I searched Trump shot and like that little like area on the Google, like when you search something on Google, like on the, I guess the right hand side of the page, where it says like see results about, all it has is mugshot of Donald Trump, and it has his fucking his prison mugshot. They're like taking it really literally there. Mugshot, Trump shot. Damn, yeah, I don't know. Updates pending, I guess. We'll see if he pulls through, folks. If his ear comes off. What if he just has like a fucking Van Gogh like bandage on his head for the rest of the campaign?
He just wears like one half of a set of wrestling headgear. It's like, folks, I gave everything. You know, so all gave some gave all. I gave all. Look at this. I was a very active listener, I'll have you know. No, I can't listen to anyone.
He just has a big, like, prosthetic plastic ear. And
no, he gets, like one of those Mr. Burns, like, earmophones.
Yeah. I'm just picturing him, like, in, like, the next debate, though, like, using it to his advantage to fuck with Biden to be like, excuse me, could you say that one
say
more
that,
time?
I'm sorry, I got shot for my country. Say it in my good ear.
Yeah.
He makes sure to get himself positioned on the fucking bad ear side against fucking Biden just so he can pretend not to hear him. Sorry, I can't hear you over all the getting shot that I did.
He's like, yeah, that's right. I know you're a communist, Joe. I know you.
Yeah, I can hear you quite well.
I've told it.
Oh, my God.
Shots fired at Trump rally. Goddamn.
There you go.
This is fucking.
That's some extra iced coffee for me. I gotta say,
something's a brewing, and it's not just the iced coffee. Well, let's see. It's kind of feels weird to go back to any of this other bullshit after that. But I mean, there's really not much.
Here's with some weird shit
information.
Here's with one of the weirder ones. Let's go.
Yeah, I agree. The thing I didn't want to miss though was this hilarious reaction in HuffPo opinion piece. It's time for the Biden campaign to embrace AI. So like after the bad debate performance, this was what they walked away with. And they essentially were just like, they should use AI to make Biden look not senile.
I mean,
but it's like it's being said like in the most at least like the tone seems to be pretty serious. Like if it was a tongue-in-cheek, like funny thing, I'd be like, all right, whatever. That's sort of funny. But like it seems like a genuine plea to the Biden team of like, let me try to pull like any like.
Well, the thing is, AI is like mostly run by like, you know, well, majority run fucking by like tech dipshits who are like probably not the most friendly to Biden. Fucking, you know, whether they want to be out loud about it or not. So an AI-generated Biden would probably just have his quirks, but just made more inhuman. So well, yeah, I think they should do it. They really should. I want to see fucking what AI can cook up in the old, like, AI. They're like, all right, how would a person with dementia speak? Got to search my AI brain here.
Well, what's hilarious about this is that, a week or two before this article, the fucking press secretary was out there telling people that, oh, there are these recent videos of Biden looking looking senile and confused and wandering around. And she's like, well, there's a lot of deep fakes and cheap fakes out there. And it's a big problem. It's a serious problem. And like, that's been the line recently. Is there like if you think Biden looks totally demented, it's because of AI. It's because of nasty AI fakeness going on. And then this person is like, let's spin that to our advantage. Like, it's just a very, like, I don't even know who the fuck wrote this, but it's a very, like, marketing.
AI wrote it, man.
Approach. Yeah, probably an AI wrote this goddamn article.
Alphonse Iglesias. AI.
Kaivin Schroff.
Yeah, that's generated by a machine.
It seems like it. K. It does. Holy. Holy shit, man. K A I V A N.
Yeah, that's fake Schroff. Bullshit. That's Star Wars shit. That's a Star Wars name generator that the AI went to.
That is a Star Wars. It's definitely the cantina.
Yeah. That's glop shit ass.
That's a Jizz Whalers name. That's someone playing jizz music.
Bob Barley and the Jizz Whalers.
It's canonical, folks. George Lucas wrote the word jizz music. Jizz Whalers are who play jizz music. But yeah, so that was just some stupid opinion piece.
I'm thinking about the piece of lead currently lodged in the 45th president's ear right now. Fucking, but back to the AI Biden shit. Fucking, do you remember it was like back in like 2021 or 2020? Fucking Biden was already like just doing weird shit with like green screens. Where remember, like he was
during COVID,
he was on like some lawn, but
in his basement.
But it was a fake ass lawn.
They did, yeah. They had the fake rose.
Yeah,
garden.
And everyone's like, "You're crazy. Yeah, that's not fake." And it's like, bro.
Yeah, there was a lot of arguments on Twitter and whatnot about like how much Biden was faking shit green screen wise for sure. Yeah, I remember that definitely being a hot topic of the day. Yeah, I don't know. Like, I want to move away from Biden, but like there's always like, yeah, okay, so let's just do it.
Do you think Hunter hired the shooter?
I mean we know Hunter's into guns. It's been established. It could be him himself on a fucking,
and the thing is,
crack,
you
bender.
Know everyone wants to talk about the crack bender, and obviously it gets away from him, but I work at a head shop for one of my jobs, you know, fucking one stop shop for adult delinquents, perverts, painters, fucking spiritual persons, potheads. Either way, we sell Pyrexes, you know, aka just a straight piece of glass, you know, which maybe some folks might not use for science, but instead for crack cocaine.
It's like one of those cigar tubes that happens
just have
to,
no cigar in it. Yeah. But the thing is, you know, sometimes crackheads come in and they buy the crack pipe. And, you know, you're like, all right, that's crackhead, that's buying a crack pipe. But then sometimes you get, like, these sort of, like, upper middle class, new metal F-150 people coming in buying them. And, like, also, like, there's, like, a few...
Killer Brian. Murder Brian.
Yeah,
I mean,
fucking...
Damn, I said Killer Brian.
That's a flub. But fucking.
That hurts. I got 1 hour sleep.
You come for the king.
That's
you what
I'm gonna bust
flub.
Out. I'm gonna bust out the 1 hour sleep card for that one. That's embarrassing.
Fine. Well, I'm 82 years old and I'm doing fine. So fucking. But goddamn, what was it? Oh yeah, crack. There are some people, and I've learned this, that have a crack life balance. Basically, they have figured out the crack life balance where, like, there's like elderly old, like, you know, black folks that like come in, like, you know, they got their, like, you know, sort of like Friday night, Sunday morning, like best on. And they're like, oh, can I get a couple of Pyrexes? And, you know, I'm like, sure thing, ma'am. You know, like, da da da. And it's like, good for her. She just, you know, gets Social Security and buys crack once a month. And then, you know, just goes back to being a nice old lady. And fucking, it's the same thing for, yeah, like, just some F-150 dads that just, you know, they have, like, their little man cave that they, like, once a month just have strippers and smoke crack in. And then it's back to business as usual. Going to church, all that shit. So some people can fucking, and obviously, like I said, with the spotlight on you, I think, that can affect your crack life balance, you know?
That's the issue.
You know, if he didn't have this fucking giant... Poor Hunter. You know, his crack life balance is getting blown all to hell by his stupid fucking dad. Fucking... Which in turn makes him just do crazy shit, like try to shoot his dad's fucking rival so that he does not go to prison in the next 4 years.
Yeah, I mean, like that was still some of the, you know, fallout from all this shit where, like, the most fucking galling thing about all this Biden shit, which I already kind of said, but I gotta say it again, because it just drives me crazy, is that, like, I've been saying he's fucking got no brain for 5 years, and, like, so have so many other people. I'm not saying just me.
Oh, yeah.
But, like, it's so funny to watch this, like, hordes of people, and I understand, like, most of them are, like, just pretending, like, they do already, but there are some people, I think, who genuinely are surprised and are like, holy shit, he's actually, it's not just right-wing Putin-funded slander to say that Joe Biden's, like, got a few screws loose. Oh my god, can you believe it?
I mean, that E1 episode fucking came out in, like, early 2020, like February 2020 or some shit, where they just had fought, like, four or five Joe Bidens talking to each other. And Yeah,
that shit was
people
hilarious.
People done been knowing.
Like, but I mean, I was seeing shit even, I mean, not like, I mean, but it's not like a contest, but, like, I mean, I remember seeing shit in 2019 that was, like, throwing together, like, you know, like montages or whatever of, like, you know, and, like, the polite people who like, still even liked Biden would still, like, poke fun at it and be like, his gaffes. But then, like, the people who are, like, more, you know, opposed to that, to the asshole, are like, no, like, he's losing his mind, like, the, you know,
yeah,
look at this corn pop speech, guys. Like, this,
I mean,
this is not,
he's been Sleepy Joe for,
well,
like,
for
how
future.
Long now, how long has he been Sleepy Joe?
I mean, I think that came around 2019-ish, because, you know, he didn't run in 2016, so Trump must have invented Sleepy Joe. I feel like Trump invented Sleepy Joe, right? I associate that with Trump.
Yeah, I don't think Trump was reading Onion and calling him Diamond Joe. You know, fucking Biden could have just bowed out and never ran for president, and everyone would have just been like, oh, there's Diamond Joe running around. I wonder what hijinks he's getting into in the fucking T-top fucking Camaro. But no.
You know, there's a really kind of interesting article that the guy who basically kind of invented that Onion character of Joe Biden wrote that was like, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
He wrote... Have you seen that?
I have, yeah. Good for him.
He wrote an apology, like, op-ed, basically. It was like, oh my god, Joe Biden is actually really evil, and we kind of made him into this, like, semi-lovable, like, cartoonish character. Mm-hmm. And I thought, like, that version of Joe Biden was funny to me. It didn't make me like him, though.
No!
I also get where it's like, it makes him seem sort of like, like, your harmless kind of, like, skeezy uncle or something. And so, like, the guy who took the most responsibility for that came out and was like, I'm sorry. Like, we should actually be maybe kind of grilling this guy taking him seriously, taking him at his word when he comes out and like unites with the fucking KKK and does eulogizes Strom Thurmond's funeral and shit.
Yeah. I mean, him eulogizing Strom Thurmond, like anyone that was surprised by like the fucking golf swing bullshit in the debate, it's like, yeah, he spoke at Strom Thurmond's fucking funeral. What do you want? These are all just guys that work to him.
And like you brought up earlier, I was that little girl, the busing thing. Like, you know, there's just like a million things. Like, I mean,
I gotta say, I'm very happy for your journey, Josh. You were that little girl at the bus stop, and now you're the man I see before me.
You know what's so cynical about that fucking Kamala thing, though, is they really planned ahead on that line to the point where they had T-shirts already printed and ready to sell at that debate that said, I was that little girl, and like had like a picture of like, you know, some.
I want to see the African or Amazonian village that ended up with a box full of those shirts.
You're right. I'm sure there is probably a tribe somewhere all wearing the Kamala t-shirts. But like, it was so fucking choreographed, the whole thing, which like that in itself is not surprising, but the fact that they had t-shirts made up with it as a catchphrase, or like, this is how Kamala's gonna pop, like she's it's her time now, like, because there were like what 20 people all fucking on stage at that point. Man, how to even fucking transition to anything else?
I gotta check Twitter real quick. I'm sorry, but
it's okay. While you're doing that, I'll just read you this hilarious Jimmy Kimmel quote, which was the early reaction to the poor Biden performance. He said, "Just because you think Alfred is too old to take care of the Bat Cave," it actually just says "take care of Bat Cave" here. "Just because you think Alfred is too old to take care of Batcave, you don't replace him with the Joker."
Let me see here. The trending shit.
Is he calling Kamala the Joker?
I don't know.
I mean, obviously not, but it kind of comes across that way. What's going on Twitter?
Let me see here.
What's the latest hubbub with Trump getting shot in the ear?
Trending topics, politics trending. They missed. Trending with how do you miss? Trending in the United States. Shooter.
This. I wonder if T-shirts are already made, just like the Kamala thing. Like hashtag they miss T-shirts are already being distributed right now.
Yep. Well, Blair White is saying.
Wait. Is how do you miss is obviously coming from the libs.
Yeah,
side,
and then
right?
They missed is okay. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. That
fucking well, Blair White. Let me see here. Just tweeted. Donald Trump took a bullet for this country. If you're voting for anyone else, you can go fuck yourself. That's where I'm at. Oh my god! Tucker Carlson posted a fucking photo of Trump being carried off by fucking Social Security. Secret Service fucking guards. But yeah, he'd be carried off by Social Security just with one hand up. Like he's a fucking athlete coming off the fucking field on the fucking... Oh my god. Yeah, this has to be a fucking... There's no way. This is insane.
I love it. This is great.
Oh, wait a minute. Dave Portnoy, 27 minutes ago, I just landed and missed an assassination attempt. The motherfucker... He ASSIGNATION. Acid.
He's so upset he can't.
He's like,
spell,
they tried
man.
To assign my president.
They tried to reassign his gender. It's fun. Goddamn butchers, as JP, good old Jordan Peterson would call them. Goddamn butchers. Well, our future president has been shot in the ear, folks. He's been dragged off the field like an injured sportsman.
He has been assigned to the injury reserve.
So was he actually hit in the ear?
Yeah, there's a fucking, like, very much like a fucking photo, yeah, of fucking him bleeding from the fucking ear.
Bleeding out of
like,
his ear?
Like, from the top of the ear. Okay. Like, it looks like he seriously got grazed in the top of his ear.
What's weird is I go to Google Images and see Trump shot, and the series of pictures is fucking wild. It's fucking wild. Oh my god, like this one that I'm looking at right here on from Fox 10 Phoenix, it looks almost, it has the same gravitas as like the U.S. soldiers at Iwo Jima, like pushing up the American flag. That's what it looks like. It's like all these Secret Service guys like carrying him off.
Fucking insane.
Holy shit.
Also, yeah, what, I just can't get over, like, the people behind him, like, in the bleachers. How do you not put this all ass away?
I feel like it's in the bag now. Am I wrong? Like, this is our next president. There's no way it's not. After all this shit with Biden, and now he gets shot in the fucking head? I mean, technically, your ear is part of your head.
God, like, damn.
He's, like you just said, whoever tweeted that shit, like, this man took a bullet for our country. Anyone who votes, like, otherwise could fuck off or whatever. Like, hang on. What the fuck is this? Oh, okay. That's not anything to do with him getting shot. That's a shot glass with his mug shot on it. With what is FAFO? FAFO. I can't see. Huh. Anyway, when you search just the words Trump shot, you get other things besides him actually being shot with a gun. Goddamn. I can't wait to hear. I'll put it this way. I can't wait to hear what Brace and Liz at True and On have to weigh in on this with, and what my favorite place on the internet, the True and On subreddit, has to say about all this. I bet they're saying something right now, actually.
It's fucking goddamn. I don't know what it is with just being awake for, I mean, I guess this makes more sense, but I remember when he got COVID, I think it was like 1:30 in the morning and I was like hanging out and then like, you know, with like roommates and shit, and then I just checked Twitter and I was like, "Oh, Trump's not COVID again." And what a time that was. But the Wriggler, he be wriggling. But holy shit. Yeah, we're fucked, man. He's got it.
Didn't Biden get COVID like 4 times? I can't remember. Or who got COVID more between the two? I can't remember. I feel like Biden got it a lot. Like more, at least twice. But I don't know.
Well, they tried to assign the president. Okay.
they tried to reassign him.
Assassination.
It ain't right.
I didn't think that's a word.
Man, there's so many posts on the True and Up subreddit right now already. The first one that comes up is Rambo 3 alternative ending. it's the picture of him with his fist raised in the air getting pulled off with the American flag flapping in the background.
God damn it.
And it says, this film is dedicated to the brave Mujahideen fighters of Afghanistan.
Jesus.
Which is how Rambo 3 ends.
Actually, yeah, I guess that fucking was maybe some Mandela effect. Because on Blowback, I think they pointed out that it actually doesn't say this film is dedicated to the brave Mujahideen fighters of Afghanistan.
Oh,
yeah.
Really?
It actually, what is I think it just says the brave like fighters or something. The brave people of Afghanistan.
Oh, okay, it doesn't say the actual.
Doesn't say Mujahideen. Okay. Yeah, it was a major.
You know. That sounds right. That sounds familiar. Yeah,
Blowback always, you know, bringing us back as to well. Reality. But God damn. That's nuts.
I mean, all right. I'm just going to scan the old list here and
let's see
if
what
there's
we
anything
got.
that can compete with this. Because, I mean, let's just say, I mean, this doesn't compete really, but like, yay, France. It looks like something went okay with your elections. Although the more I'm reading about it, it's like not as awesome as it's
a bunch of parliamentary shit.
But Le Pen got humiliated, which is good because she used to call Hitler like Unky Hitler whenever he came on the TV. She's a real fascist, so fuck her and her whole team, and they apparently were humiliated by all that. and the left-wing coalition came out on top, but not by a ton, I guess, either. And Biden did some more racist shit, but that's old news. It was basically he just did some more kind of like, if you don't vote for Biden, you ain't black, Jack, kind of equivalent to that on the radio.
Yeah.
A robot suicide rocks South Korea. Authorities investigate a, quote, depressed cyborg sudden, quote, death. I don't know. I think
That was kind of interesting. Other than the fact that it just looks like a fucking... It looks like a rolling fucking like cat litter box or something.
Yeah, it's also.
I mean, you're over there. What's it like out there with all the robots apparently running around?
It's really not like that, as far as I know. I mean, I don't know. Like the shit that I've seen, I think is already like just as plentiful in the U.S., if not more so. Like. Dish collecting robots at a buffet restaurant, which were really annoying because they're really like they play really loud music when they stop by your area and try to your filthy buffet trays and plates and whatnot.
Do they have a tipping screen on them, or are they just strictly working on an hourly?
We're like the rest of the world, man. Tipping is not. Cool.
Tipping is a city in China. I don't know if it is.
I think the U.S. is like literally the only country, the only like I don't know, quote unquote major country where tipping is like how people get by in life, and most other places like it's just like it's actually like almost like offensive to do it. I've done it like a handful of times with cab drivers when like they were really cool and like went out of their way and were just like really good at being cabbies and were really friendly and they were like barely accepted the money I tried to give them. Like I've lived here like 12 years and I've probably done that like twice in 12 years.
Just make up a religion. Be like, it's my religion. Just take it.
And the cabs are, I mean, compared to the U.S., like, super cheap here.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. They also go on strike probably once a year, I feel like. There's, like, a day where there's, like, no taxis because they're just, like, because they do get fucked over pretty bad. But, yeah, I guess the real thing about the robot committing suicide in Korea is just that the suicide rate is like there's like a dark joke in there somewhere about like the high rate of suicide in this country.
Is it pretty bad?
Even the robots are doing it. Yeah, it's very bad. Like kids commit suicide a lot. Ooh. Because of like pressures of studying in like once you hit middle school, your life is kind of. Shit.
It's like prep school or the fucking, you know, shop or whatever.
Even if you're poor and in like regular like public school, like everything is like leads up to this huge test that you take that determines like what kind of college you're going to get into, essentially. And it's like such a big deal here that like they literally organize the flights out of the international airports. Around the testing days so that like they don't have planes flying over certain areas to like, you know, disrupting the, the tests. Yeah. And I walk over this one bridge a lot that's like essentially like the suicide bridge, which, you know, that's fun. There's like various times they do certain things to the bridge, like discourage people from committing suicide. Sometimes it's like almost makes it more depressing.
They have like some giant plushies that just say you can do it.
It's not currently this way, but like at one point I remember they just had like, it was just like pictures of like family members and kids left behind from like people that did commit suicide. And then they, and like right now, all that's there. They took all the pictures down, and now it's just a mirror. So, like, forces you to look at yourself in the face before you try to scale this. And they also, like, just put up, like, a big, like, fence that, like, curves inward. So it's, like, very hard to climb over, essentially. But then it's like you look across, you look down the river, like both other directions, and there's like 20 bridges on both sides. So it's like,
I thought you were going to say you look on either side of the bridge and there's CrossFit gyms so that you can get in shape to climb that fence and really work towards something. They're like, in 1 month, we will have a suicide ready body for you and this bridge.
CrossFit and you know, vanity health stuff is pretty big here now, so they could incorporate that. That might help.
By the time you're like jacked enough to climb the anti-suicide fucking thing, you have so many endorphins, like, you know, whatever, dopamine going, that you're like, yeah, maybe I don't know, maybe I'll just become a CrossFit instructor. Fuck it, I can work this into the story of my journey. I was like you, about to kill myself, and then I couldn't climb the anti-suicide bridge, so. Then I got in really good shape, and then I didn't want to kill myself anymore.
Yeah, that's the happy ending. I was thinking the dark ending of, like, I got into shape enough to get over, just to climb over the fucking bridge.
Well, I mean, that's, like, something I've always considered, is just, like, the idea of, like, rage quitting life, like, just a rage suicide, where, like, you just get caught off by somebody in traffic, and you're like, fuck it! You just get out of the car and just, like, let it idle over your head. You're like, yep, you did this to me, it's done! Like, just like someone that, like, had nothing else going wrong, and then they're just like, fuck it! I think, I don't know, there's definitely, it's probably happened, but, you know, I don't know, it's definitely not happened enough. So people aren't getting mad enough anymore. Probably from all the fluoride in the water.
That's gotta be it. Gay frogs and whatnot. Yep.
Gay frogs, man, they don't reproduce asexually. They watch porn, so they don't gotta fuck. They just, you know, fucking have their cum rag that eventually just becomes another little tadpole, and then fucking bing, bang, boom.
I mean, speaking of cum rags and loneliness, here's a headline. Man fined for squirting mixture of urine and flour onto woman's dress to try to chat her up. This happened in Singapore, it looks like.
Was the guy Malaysian?
Tan Jun Hao, yes, 31-year-old Malaysian, was fined $1,200. I don't know if that's U.S. Probably Singapore. Singapore has dollars, so it's probably Singaporean dollars, which are worth a lot more than U.S. dollars, so that's probably a hefty fine.
well, good.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't.
Why the fuck are you mixing? What is the point of the urine with the flour? Like, what is that supposed to look like?
And you see this guy's sad face. It sort of all kind of makes sense.
I mean, he still looks better than also, Malaysia's greatest son, fucking Ian Miles Strong.
Oh, right.
So maybe you should just start streaming, fucking idiot.
Yeah, get on Twitter.
Yeah,
man.
I'm sure you can meet some babes that way.
His whole angle was basically like he... So it says the woman initially thought that this mixture was bird droppings due to its smell. The accused intended to squirt the mixture on the clothes of ladies, especially young ladies wearing dark colored bottoms, and then alert them that their clothes had been dirtied. This is just sad. Why did I pick this article out?
Yeah, I'm trying to think of what fucking...
I mean, it is fucking weird, though, too.
You could also just ask them for the time. I don't know. Put your watch in your pocket. Like, excuse me, do you have the time?
Exactly. Like, it's just kind of like there are 100 other things you could think of before you land on
this. Yeah, it's a weird
plan.
Shit on you.
Like, maybe it's just all the, like, mocking Jordan Peterson shit lately, but just, like, it all kind of, like, tied together when I came across this weird article. Just these sad young men that make Jordan Peterson weep uncontrollably.
Yeah. Coming soon to a Twitch or Twitter near you.
See what they did in Boston to revitalize the public transit system? They put googly eyes on the front of the trains. to make it happier.
Well, it's funny because I read the headline to this and then I read like the story itself. And initially it sounded like, oh, her train was late. So I was like, thought this was like just some crazy Boston person that's like, all right, well, if the fucking train's going to be late, might as well give them some fucking googly eyes for their fucking goofy asses. And whatever accent that is. But no, it turns out she's just some Canadian that's like, I just like to introduce a little whimsy everywhere I go. And yeah. From what I saw from the photos, these aren't even real googly eyes, because like it seems like the eyes are just facing about 10 o'clock, you know, on a fucking clock. And it's like,
Yeah.
No. I want the googly eyes to move, especially with the train. I just want to see him fucking like just jiggle and shake. You can put them in some oil or something they don't move quite as fast. But come on, I want some googling.
Stealing googly-eyed valor for sure. It just made me think about the state of U.S. infrastructure, I guess. That was mainly my angle.
Then
on
also
it.
Organizing. And she talks about how she organized among, you know, fucking, and da-da-da-da. I was like, oh, I don't know, for the fucking train people to get paid more, or like more lines or more access to the trains. No, we just want googly eyes. Okay.
It's such a perfect example of, you know, like people, like, it's like slapping a Band-Aid on, like a gunshot wound.
Yeah.
I guess bring up Trump again.
Put a bird on it. Come on.
But like, just... Yeah, this the state of public transit is pretty sad. And the place where it's not is a little country I like to call China. And one of my favorite style of stories is basically you find something that China did that's pretty cool, that's pretty based, and then you as a stupid American journalist have to go ... but at what cost? ... because they're our mortal enemy and they're making us look bad and whatnot. And they do effective soft imperialism on the global South nations instead of just, you know, killing everybody and raping the natural resources and whatnot. Yes, I am paid by the Chinese government. I wish. I don't know. A couple. I mean, like, I think I was saying earlier, like I see so many of these stories like every week, and I think I only grabbed like a handful of them. But one of them was the Chinese retirement age is 54, and there's an article written about this that is just saying like, it's a huge problem. It's too young. And the Economist, right above the headline, it says, China, vanguard of the non-working class. Take that.
My knowledge of China is, and also just Chinese people, is that like there's definitely like a cultural thing to save like one third of your money at all times. And I think that might be almost a Pan-Asian thing, because I think I have a friend who's like mom is like half Korean, and like she got from her Korean family, yeah, you just save like a third or half of everything you make and da 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 da, and fucking, because, you know, yeah, you gotta retire, blah blah blah. But like, because yeah, like a while back, weren't like credit card companies like fucking trying to break into China? And then they're like, yeah, they just keep on just spending a little bit and then paying it off immediately. And they don't seem to get it. They don't seem to want to become slaves to us. It's fucked up.
But, yeah, what the hell?
Yeah, and yeah, I'll take a fucking age 54. I mean, that means I got 14 years to go. I'll take that. Fucking make your move, G. And also, like, going back to an earlier point when we were talking about the whole Korean school system and everything, didn't G, like, a couple years ago, like, basically declare war on homework, and he like got rid of like a bunch of like the fucking like prep, like private prep schools, like in test prep shit, because he's like,
there's a thing. Yeah, you're right. There was a I just read about this the other day. There's a guy I follow on Twitter. He's like this French guy who's been living in China forever. I can't even think of his name off the top of my head, but you know, he's he's cool. He's good independent journalist. Hell yeah. And he was talking all about this, about how, like, his, you know, like, he sends his daughter to, you know, these prep schools and whatever. And there was sort of a war on, I mean, like, a war on homework is one way to put it, I guess. What I gathered was, it was like, I don't know if it's quite as idealistic as that either. It was more, but, like, yeah, I think the idea was, though, that, like, we're, like, overworking these kids, but at the same time,
the parents are having to work their ass off to afford the fucking schooling so that they can get the extra schooling in order to get into the schooling.
And it's also just an issue of sheer numbers of, like, there's only so many universities and there's so many students. So, like, there is, like, a fairly large number of kids that are, like, not going to get into these, like, whatever, like, top schools and whatever. But, like, they said essentially that, like, certain, like, tutoring things had been outlawed, but that it didn't really actually make any difference. Damn. That, like, everyone knows you can still just, like, go to these, like, illegal, quote unquote, like, tutoring schools and whatnot.
I want to know what vice cops for the tutoring schools are like. They're like, you know, 21 right. Jump Street shit, where they're like, oh, I'm just a 16-year-old boy looking to get into fucking Shanghai University. They're like, if only there was someone that could help me in my studies.
I remember hearing, like, stories, like, about here in Korea about, like, if you don't have, like, you know, a specific teaching visa and you get caught teaching, you can, like there have been busts done. Like, they've done sting operations and shit. I think it's, like, really fucking rare. And, like, I remember hearing about this, like, 10, 12 years ago. But apparently it does happen in theory.
I hope they just, like, hired one group of fucking, you know, prep school cops and then just never hire new ones. So they're just getting older and older all the time. Some, like, fucking 46-year-old lady in, like, you know, a fucking, like, sailor fucking outfit or whatever. And it's just like, yep, here to study. Anyone want to teach me? You're certified, right? You have to tell me. This is entrapment.
Are you a real tutor? You got to tell me. The other headline I found, which I don't think I put in our notes or anything, but I'll just say the headline because it falls totally in line with this ... but what at what cost thing. Also from The Economist, shockingly, China is using archaeology as a weapon. It's just like anything can be weaponized. And I read the article and it's just bullshit. It's like trying to say that the state is unearthing ancient justifications for its rule over the Uyghurs.
Oh, because no one's ever done that before. Fucking, yeah, Israel, I'm looking at you, fucking bullshit artist. Fucking
until I see anything that says otherwise, the whole fucking fiction about Chinese genocide against the Uyghurs is, well, I just said it, it's fiction. Like, there's no fucking genocide. Xinjiang is, like, a great place to live from everything I could find out about it. But that's, like, you know, to, like, really dig in deep, that would be, like, a whole episode or something. But
I mean, if anything, it just seems to me like, I mean, I could see, like, the Chinese, you know, government writ large, like, just being like, all right, everyone can believe whatever the fuck as long as, you know, those beliefs don't get in the way of the business of doing business sort of a thing.
I think all that really, what it really comes down to is there were a handful of terror attacks in that region, and there's probably some, like, you know, maybe ethically dubious, like, re-education style stuff. But it wasn't, like, torture, and it wasn't genocide. They weren't trying to, like, displace or kill a group of people. They were like, hey, we're gonna, like, give you some, like, job skills so you don't have to be terrorists. And, you know, anyway, like I said, it could be a whole fucking episode if you really wanted to, like, take it, like, get seriously into it. But, like, it drives me fucking bonkers when I still hear, like literally, like, 2 weeks ago, Anthony Blinken goes to China and says, these Chinese are committing genocide. It's just like, who the fuck do you think you are, asshole? Like, what the fuck? What planet do you live on? Do you see what the United States government is almost directly doing themselves, like, around the world? Anyway, I know certain people might, you know, give me some flack for being a fucking a Chinaman apologist, a real Xi stan. One of my favorite go-tos on the TrueAnon subreddit, you know, the only place where a kid can be a kid, where a tanky can be a tanky, is people yelling out, sort of half seriously, please, President Xi, save me. And I feel it. I feel it. So yeah, but at what cost? Being Chinese, but at what cost? I don't know. There were a bunch of weird things in here. Anything that caught your eye?
I mean, unfortunately,
I can tell.
Yeah, we kind of had that bomb dropped on the episode that like just exploded all information in my head.
I mean, I can tell you what the one that was all in Korean was about. Was there's a proposed bill in South Korea now to punish non-contact sexual crimes such as body fluid terrorism, which is...
Well, I mean, isn't that just the Singapore guy thing? Only that wasn't bodily. Well, there was urine, so that is bodily fluid. So is this just another piss and flour thing?
It's very similar, because I think when you mix piss and flour, you're essentially making jizz.
I mean, it has to be some hydrated piss. I mean, we can't be doing, like, bad teammate piss.
Well, it depends on the ratio flour, I suppose.
And
well,
also if it's bleached, like, you know, if you have, like, just, you know, unbleached, you know, natural flour.
True.
That's going to be...
If you want to get the right scent and all that, yeah. yeah, this was basically, it's like the quote unquote funny aspect to it is that it's currently not illegal to just like jizz on someone's stuff. It's not considered, that's not true. It's still illegal because it's like, but it's considered like destruction of property. And what they want to do. See, like, I'm explaining away the clickbait, like, hilarity of it all, I guess, which is the kind of the whole point of this, is they want to make that
sex crime,
like, considered basically a sex crime, sexual harassment, I think. Yeah.
Law and Order SVU, Korea. And it's just, yeah, this guy just keeps on coming on everyone's shoes.
They do cite various examples of the article that are pretty fucking gross. But yeah, it's basically stuff like that. I mean, oh my God. This is like way too dark to bring up now. I just want to say, all right. Well, we can just end on this. I mean, I don't... Israel, folks.
We hate it.
No, I know. Here's a more lighthearted Israel related story, and it builds on to something we've brought up on the show recently. Israelis trying to take back the watermelon. Hashtag take back the watermelon. Have you heard about this? Have you heard about this, folks? They are literally trying to. They're saying that, well, watermelons were invented by Israelis, and then some of them are like now saying the seedless watermelon was invented by Israel, which is just patently not true. I like knew as a little kid that was like made by Japanese scientists. I remember like knowing that as a
yeah, Unit 731. They were fucking doing all those experiments on the fucking watermelons.
Yeah, it brings us full circle back to how Biden's gonna reinstate Imperial Japan.
They're like, first we sterilize the boy, and then we sterilize another boy, and then we sterilize a third boy, and then we try to sterilize these watermelons, and then we're gonna go from there.
Folks, I'm gonna bring back the seedless boy watermelon to Korea and Japan. Imperial Japan, the sun will rise
in the East.
Here's what we're going to do. We got these migrant workers. We're here in Japan. We got these migrant workers. We made the seedless watermelon. We're going to make the seedless migrant worker. That way, no one. So it's just us. Just us. No one else is having babies here. Just us.
Seedless migrant. Yeah. So they're continuing this, or some, I don't know, weird psychopath Israeli people are trying to take back the watermelon via like TikTok videos. And
you know
shit,
what's annoying as piss?
And, the most recent...
I hate fucking watermelon. I hate watermelon. Like, I'm not a huge watermelon fan.
Ooh, I can't go with you there.
I can get down with some watermelon-flavored candies.
Juice today, earlier today.
Yeah, just watermelon or just straight-up watermelon juice. Get it out of my face. Gross, disgusting, foul. But if a watermelon pisses off fucking, you know, a Zionist, I will wear a Hawaiian shirt with a bunch of fucking watermelons on it. I'm not going to eat watermelon. Save that for the people that enjoy the watermelon and the people that hate and fear the watermelon for what it represents. I want nothing to do with the watermelon, except for aesthetically just to upset Zionists. Fucking. And then my other food-related tragedy to the day is, I'm allergic to avocado, which as a fucking millennial, you know, you see all the avocado toast memes and you can't eat the...
You might as well just jump off that CrossFit bridge we were talking about.
Yeah,
earlier.
I better fucking like just start working on my weird, shitty looking fucking pull-ups so I can just hurt my way up. If I blow my back out or my shoulder on the way up, as long as I can get up and over the lip, no one will ever know. Ooh, or I could fucking fail and, you know, have to call an ambulance for my bad back because I blew my back out trying to climb the thing using a fucked up CrossFit. Then I go to the hospital and, just steal a fucking, you know, scalpel and, you know, just stab the shit out of myself. And, you know, hopefully it'll finally be over. My fitness journey will be over once and for all. But, yeah.
Well, I appreciate that as much as you're skeeved out by the watermelon as a food stuff that you you would wear the symbol of one, because that's the whole point that these Israelis, it seems, lost on them, is that you assholes literally made the Palestinian flag illegal, so they had to resort to another symbol, which happens to have red, green, white, black.
Not the seedless watermelon.
They seem to like, yeah, right, then there's no black. But then, yeah, in the most recent video I saw, like, they were like chopping up a watermelon. It was just this fucking like horrible Karen with a Y instead of an E, which I feel like makes it worse. just going, Israel invented watermelon. And then she like, she remembers, she like said the word Israel just like in an American accent, but then the second time she says it, she puts some stank on it because she's like, oh yeah, I just remembered I'm supposed to try to be, you know, indigenous to this region. Israel invented the watermelon. But yeah, so they're still trying to take back the watermelon. And this whole thing that came out recently, I'm not going to dwell on this, but like, my angle on it is more that it's so infuriating how long it took for this to like sort of break through to, I guess, the mainstream. But the whole thing about the Hannibal directive going down and like how many people on Oct 7 were actually killed by Israeli forces sending down hellfire missiles upon everyone, and how there is this protocol called the Hannibal protocol or doctrine or whatever, where it's better to just kill fellow Israeli soldiers or people, fellow Israelis, than have them be able to be used as leverage, be kidnapped.
I mean, Israel always and forever gives more of a fuck about Israel than it does dead Jews, so.
Oh, yeah. But and it's fucked up and everything. But like, I was even talking about this shit through sources like the Gray Zone, Electronic Intifada, Mondo Vice, and some other even like smaller than those ones. They were talking about this shit like in October. And people like Ryan Grimm and Jeremy Scahill at the intercept, you know, now they've seen the light. Now they're like doing the right reporting. But there was a time when they were like looking down just like everybody else at these like more sort of quote unquote fringe outlets that have just proved over and over again to be fucking right about this shit, like way before everyone else. And it kind of drives me crazy when I listen to fucking Chapo Trap House and Ryan Grimm and Jeremy Scahill go on and go, we were the first brave journalists to break the story that the mass rapes New York Times story was bullshit. And it's like, no, you weren't. You weren't even close. These other, like, these smaller outlets were doing the same exact journalism that you ended up getting around to 6, 7, 8 months fucking after the fact. It just, I don't know. It's not like it's like a pissing contest. It's not like, oh, like, they were there first, like, they should be getting more props or whatever. But it's like, you guys wrote this off just like the Washington Post and the New York Times.
Did they?
Maybe not as flippantly, but like there is some kind of like sneering their nose at the gray zone that gets done by those guys. And look, I like those guys in general, and I'm glad that they left The Intercept, which is like a recent thing. And they do good reporting, but literally the stuff they're getting like a bunch of praise for by like people like Chapo or whatever is shit that Max Blumenthal and Aaron Maté and other people whose names I can't conjure up off the top of my head were screaming from the fucking rafters. Like,
I mean, in my eyes,
in October, like months
ago. I mean,
ago,
in my eyes, yeah, it does.
They were being ridiculed as like conspiracy theory, you know, nutcases, essentially. And that's the part that kind of
It is a bummer, but I think also sometimes people just gotta throw some ego aside for the fucking whole project. And yeah, it sucks.
For sure, and like, I actually don't even see, like, Max Blumenthal bitching about it.
He's probably privately fucking, you know, but like I said, like, in...
I would bitch about it too, though, because, like, there was a point where The Intercept was repeating some of the fucking propaganda as well. And at the same time, the Gray Zone, etc., Electric Intifada as well, they're like, they were on board at the same time, really. Like, they were reporting a lot of this stuff that was like, all the same information was there before. It just, like, it took Ryan Grimm and Jeremy Scahill many months longer to fucking get around to it. And sure, maybe they did a little more due diligence.
There's a question, of, like, if Ryan Grimm and, you know, blah, 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 were on board months earlier, would that have changed anything? Or would they have
just didn't
correct earlier? Like, because if it wasn't going to actually change anything, then who really gives a fuck?
You're right, and that's why I'm sort of wondering why I'm like.
I mean, it's annoying, but also we're
a little worked up about it.
We have to like sort of self-aggrandize ourselves and shit, especially in this day and age. They're like starting some new fucking thing, so they definitely have to like sort of like throw their balls out there and like do the thing. But I mean, it's shitty, and
I just think it would be cool if they like threw some credit towards these people that were like on board with the same exact story way in advance, but they won't because they're like competitors or whatever.
I mean, that's the fucking system and world that we're in.
Yeah, it's true. And like, I mean, ultimately I don't really care that much, but like, it's a little fucking hobby horse. I mean I've talked about this before, like, but it came up again with regards to this whole Hannibal Directive thing like coming to light because like Israeli newspapers. But the thing is also the Israeli newspapers were talking about this shit months ago as well. It's just like now it's, you know, a certain article like breaks through and then, oh, holy shit, now it's real because the New York Times repeated it. Now it's real. Before it was just loony, gray zone, conspiracy shit. But now it's real.
I mean, it's like a river or something. Anyway. I don't know, fucking like one drop of water, even if it's the best tasting drop of water in the world, is not going to, you know, offer nutrients to the fucking ground to grow the crops and this and that, da 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 da. Like, it's a whole fucking river. It's a whole bunch of drops of water. So, I mean, big picture, I really, like, I don't know, yeah, back in, like, 2020, I want to say, like, I fucking, like, basically, like, I didn't block her, but I definitely muted Bree Joy Gray. when she started, like, she had went solo, and then fucking the Felix shit happened, this and that. And then, like, she was just, like, starting fights all over the place online, and then, like, fucking, like, was just bitching about, like, you know, getting, like, de-pushed, or, like, she's like, oh, I'm, like, I've been getting more followers every month until recently, like, you know, what happened? Like, and it's like, you became fucking annoying and, like, just made yourself the news instead of fucking talking about the fucking news. Like, so, I mean, like I said, yeah, like, definitely there could probably be some DMs and this and that, but I think if everyone could put their ego and, like, you know, this and that aside for the whole, you know, greater picture and project, I think that could go a long way, and that's for media people to dipshits like me and everyone else in between. I don't know.
But yeah, but sure, but then that, like, that goes in every direction. That goes to Ryan Grimm and Intercept as well. Like, they should, you know, give credit.
Well, it sounds like they left the fucking Intercept. But, so, you know, I mean, I think that's a statement.
They did. And I think I think that's cool. And I hope that maybe now they'll, like, you know, I don't know. I guess mostly I'm just shouting out again places like Electronic Intifada,
absolutely,
and Gray Zone and Mondo Vice, because I don't know, they got it right way before everybody else. What can I say? Like, and it's happened multiple times on multiple,
they get read issues, and, like, you know, fucking interacted with by, you know, fucking freaks like us, like, you know, fucking, not, they're not the New York Times or the Intercept or the Washington Post. So I mean, I don't know. It sucks, but it is what it is.
But I mean, I guess that's what I'm saying. Is, I mean, that's what's frustrating about it. But, like, I get it. I understand also why. Anyway, I suppose
I'm gonna check Joe Biden's Twitter real quick, see if he has anything to say about.
Oh shit, that's a great idea. But yeah, I suppose that's a good place to start winding down. The old
let's see here. All right, 22 minutes ago, I have been briefed on the shooting at Donald Trump's rally in Pennsylvania. I'm grateful to hear that he's safe and doing well. I'm praying for him and his family and for all those who were at the rally as we await further information. Jill and I are grateful to the Secret Service for getting him to safety. There's no place for this kind of violence in America. We must unite as one nation to condemn it. Fuck you.
Yeah, that's about as, that's as boilerplate as you can.
That's I'm losing in fucking November.
I'm just trying to picture what switching it around. What I mean, honestly, Trump would probably basically say the same thing if it happened to Biden.
Oh, they'd be like, wow, what did he do to make everyone so mad at him?
Yeah, there would be some subtle dig, I feel like, in there still somehow.
Trump is still waiting on that golf game, or fucking Biden's still waiting on that goddamn golf game with Trump. Fucking Jesus Christ.
I did just scroll past something to all right, I swear, to round everything out. This is one of the but at what, this is a third but at what cost thing. So there's 1.4 billion people in China, right? Stabbings happened over the I think 4th of July weekend. This is a little bit dated. Two people got stabbed in the entire country of China over that weekend. This is the perfect example of but at what cost type anti-Chinese shit. So China stabbing attacks raise concerns of growing social tensions. Economic doldrums, unemployment, and isolation could be playing into crime wave, analysts say. This is the headline and subheadline about two people getting stabbed to death in China over a weekend, compared with 101 people shot in Chicago over that same weekend, and essentially zero coverage about this happening.
Yeah, but isn't that like whataboutism, man? Like, you know, you're gonna be like, really, you want to bring up fucking, you know, Chicago? You want to go to Chicago for that? Fucking come on, man. But
well, just
I do fear getting stabbed, but also I would rather not get shot. So you know, but also, yeah, two people out of 1.4 billion versus 100 out of 300.
I was gonna say, it's just math. It's just really basic math.
I mean, I guess find out what block that those two stabbings happened on, and maybe just stay out of like that square mile.
Yeah, I didn't really dig deep into that. By which I mean, I didn't look into it at all. But I do know that the gun violence in Chicago is insane, and there's no equivalent in the entire nation of China.
Maybe the guy that shot Trump was from Chicago, since Chicago likes to shoot people so much.
It's gotta be. Just think of...
They bust him in. The Antifa super soldiers bust in the Chicago gang member thug to shoot Donald J. Trump.
Man, I'm so weirdly happy that... Not even weirdly. Of course I'm fucking happy that this happened while we're recording.
Of course, you're not on wrestling Twitter, but a bunch of wrestling Twitter is basically saying, yeah, he went underneath the podium and bladed.
I'm not a wrestling guy, but I follow that logic. I got it.
And some people are like, yeah, but the ear? And the answer is, bitch, I believe at this first Starcade, Roddy Piper versus Jesus Christ, Greg the Hammer Valentine in a dog collar match. They were like attached to each other by a chain and dog collars. And Roddy Piper's ear.
Sexy.
Yeah, Roddy Piper's ear got busted open in that match, and he was just bleeding hellaciously from the ear. And it could have been from an errant strike from a chain, but most likely it was just from a little razor blade that he had in his wrist tape, which he then just gigged his ear. And I'm saying, I think Trump fucking gigged his ear. Because it's too fucking perfect. It's too fucking perfect.
That would almost make me respect him begrudgingly if that were the case.
I mean, I don't know.
That, because he's such a non-physical person, Trump, like in every way.
Oh,
which
yeah.
Which is why I have a hard time fully buying into the story that he punched Don Jr. for not wearing a full suit to a baseball game.
I mean, they didn't say it was a hard punch.
True. But even I don't know, just the idea of him I guess maybe back in the day, yeah, I could see it. But you know what I'm saying? Like nowadays, he's just this big fucking Stay Puft Marshmallow Man. Like, he just kind of lumbers around. Like, if he had the...
I mean, I think the return guys really are the winners in this thing, because used to be that, you know, you shot a president while he was out in an open air area with a bunch of people. You know, fucking back in the 60s, you know, when Mad Men was happening and men were men, you know, we killed a president that way. And now, fucking six or seven pops of a gun.
It only took one magic bullet, too.
Yeah, so return. We need to return to back when, you know, you could actually shoot a president. Fucking, and not just whatever fake bullshit this is. But who the fuck knows? This is about to get fucking bonkers.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it is truly I think people are going to definitely bring up the Teddy Roosevelt shit. And if Trump was a real badass, he would have fired back with two revolvers or whatever.
Trump just
Did Teddy Roosevelt fire back, or is that...
No, I don't think so. I think he just kind of... No, I want to say he just kind of walked off the stage for a bit, and then he came back.
I think the legend is he finished his speech.
Yeah.
But that may be all legend, apocryphal shit. But it was the bullet was stuck, because that was in the days when fucking handguns were weak as shit.
Yeah.
Right? So I think the bullet was stopped by it was stopped by his speech. It was he had the speech was so long, it was folded up in his pocket.
He had the Matrix printer paper,
just the dot matrix paper folded up, stopped the bullet. And he was like, fuck you. I got my six shooters on, and I'm going to keep giving my goddamn speech.
He's like, if this had happened two more inches to the left, it would have made it right through that collated hole in the paper.
No one's going to stop my speech about how we were right to enslave every Filipino on Earth. God damn it.
He's like, these Filipino assassins will not assign me to the fucking grave, motherfucker.
This is the, oh man, you're right. I kind of can't wait to see how much this shit fucking pops off. It's gonna be wild on the internet. I know you said you sort of temporarily erased yourself from Twitter, but I feel like you got your back, right?
I'm not gonna put it back on my phone, but I will definitely come up to my laptop a little bit okay. more over the next probably 8 to 16 hours. I will probably be checking from time to time.
Because that's where the real breaking news is, right? So
oh god, yeah, what a fucking doozy to land fucking while recording. That's nuts.
Seriously, I
shouts out to me and my coffee break. I wouldn't have had my roommate tell me if I hadn't been out,
right? It's
stay hydrated, stay caffeinated, kids.
Kismet, as the watermelon taker backers say. So we like to do little general recommendations at the end to finish out the show. I'll just go ahead with mine. If you want to think of something, if you don't, that's fine. You know, it's a whatever situation with this general recs thing. I'm going to go ahead and recommend commune with the natural world, folks. even if you need your phone to do it. Like, not saying you need to like radically change your consciousness that much, but you know,
look at the fucking clouds. It doesn't
have to be an all or nothing proposition. That's what I'll say. So like, if you're near a body of water suitable for swimming, fucking go for it. If you like laying in a field, go ahead. If you like climbing a tree, get your ass up in that tree. Let's try to appreciate stuff, guys, if you can. It's way easier said than done. I guess what inspired this recommendation is the name of this podcast is in reference to like the ultimate end of things. So I'm often thinking about declines and whatnot. We've got our climate situation going on. So what I'm saying is, that tree in your backyard might not be there too much longer. Or at least maybe you might not be there too much longer to climb it. So get on up, as James Brown would say. And then I'll say, you can also watch a movie.
Horizon.
Do it outside.
An American Saga, outside. Chapter One.
Yeah, get your Costner, your bloated, blowhard Costner fucking bullshit on.
He has a sex scene in the movie, brother. Let me tell you about the sex scene. He's supposed to be some 30 or 40 something year old cowboy, and then he's protecting some whore. And she, to say thank you, basically like starts like mounting him, like, you know, just sort of pulls the skirt, you know, the big poopy skirt up, and he's like, I'm all used up from riding today. And she's like, that's fine. And then so 69-year-old fuck Kevin Costner has a sex scene where he never takes off his clothes and just lays flat on his back like a fucking corpse. And it's very romantic. And then Luke Wilson shows up eventually. And,
Oh, man, this all sounds so bad.
Yeah, you might want to hit an episode on it. I'm going to be honest. But you have to watch it the way I did, with no subtitles, because it felt like watching a TV show with no subtitles. Fucking down to one of the actors. It was like the guy from like Slither and like Henry, Portrait of a Killer. The dad from Mallrats.
Oh, Michael Rooker. Michael Rooker.
Yeah, he plays some grizzled old fucking union, like, you know, fucking troop from Ireland. And he's got a big gray beard, and he's just like, yeah, you see, the thing is, all the guys are pedophiles.
Yeah, he's one of those guys who chews rocks while he speaks, yeah.
Yeah, and without subtitles. Me and my friend were just cracking up in the fucking theater because you couldn't understand a word he was saying. It's a beautiful piece of cinema.
I gotta figure out a way to get a 500 milligram edible, and then I'll go watch this movie. I kind of just picked a movie at random that popped into my head. As I look at what I wrote down here, it feels very pretentious, but whatever, who cares? You know, the great Japanese master Kurosawa, he made this movie back in the 50s called Ikkyuru, which I remember seeing back in my film class days in the college, and it being a very memorable thing. Basically, the premise and the whole plot, as far as I remember it, is a very like NPC guy living in Tokyo, the big bright city. He gets like a death sentence, stomach cancer diagnosis, and deals with it all by his lonesome, just wandering through the bright lights, little back alleys of Tokyo in the 1950s, and it's a great movie. It's Ikkyuru, Ikkyuru, I believe. Now I feel like I
Ikkyuru,
not...
which is actually Japanese for Horizon. Horizon in American Saga Chapter 1 is actually a really weird remake of Ikkyuru.
I looked it up just to make sure I was spelling it right, which I... wasn't actually. It's Ikkyuru, and it just means to live in Japanese, but we can also say it means horizon.
Yes, in American Saga Chapter 1.
It's actually not that much shorter than Horizon. I mean, well, 40 minutes shorter, but still.
Well, Horizon's about to be 12 hours long, brother, because he has he already has Chapter 2 filmed and ready to release in August. And then, apparently, there's supposed to be a Chapter 3 and 4, but considering that apparently so far it's only made $11 million of its $300
million. Oof.
Yeah, that's apparently his wife divorced him over this movie.
God damn.
So you know Costner. What? Do Kevin a fucking favor and go see the fucking movie.
He needs to make a Bodyguard 2 or something, you know? Get like a hit soundtrack going.
No movie like has that. A hit soundtrack anymore.
I know. You gotta bring it back, though. Just AI render Whitney and make it happen.
Fucking Jesus Christ. I don't know. They could make a really sad sequel to fucking The Bodyguard where he just shows up at like her grave and he's like, couldn't save you from that pipe.
That's the whole movie.
Just him just being like, I, you know,
moping
yeah.
around where, but he's like in the Wild West for no reason as well, just wearing a cowboy hat.
He's actually just he's on the set of Horizon, and he's like, "Do you guys need any on-set security?" And Kevin Costner's like, "No, get out of here, you piece of shit! I heard you let her die."
God when I damn. Think of that movie and that song, I remember something kind of cute about my girlfriend that she told me. She said she remembers being a little kid and hearing that song, and you know, she's Korean. She didn't really speak English at the time, and she assumed that the lyrics were "Endalia" instead of "and I will always love you." And Dahlia. Oh, yeah. So that's how I hear it.
But then she still heard the "will always love you."
Yeah, probably. I don't know. I didn't really grill her about it. I was just like, oh, that's cute. But I shouldn't.
You're like, you understood the "I love you," right? Because that happens in K-pop and shit too, same as J-pop, doesn't it? Like just random English phrases and songs.
Oh, there's tons. Like it's almost like, I'm not like a big, I'm not a K-pop person at all, but
I'm not fucking gay.
Look, Blackpink is basically pornography, and I like that stuff. So I like K-pop in that to that degree for that reason. But no, it's like so much English. Like it's like I feel like it's more English than Korean. It's probably technically not true, but like the majority of the K-pop stuff that I come across, like the band names for sure are like, I can't even think of one that's actually in Korean. They're all in English, but yeah, a lot of lyrics are in English. But anyway, was your Gen Rec Horizon taking 500 milligrams of edibles and watching Horizon?
My general recommendation is go see Horizon, fucking, so that Kevin's divorce isn't in vain. And also, speaking of J-pop and J-rock, my homie Richard and the homies in the band Yambag are on tour in Japan right now. And yesterday, I've been following along on Instagram and shit. Fucking follow him at Saucepan Rex. That's a wreck. But either way, they played in what looked like, I don't know, like a high school music room. Like, it was, like, very well lit, like, you know, sort of, like, basketball floor, like, wood floor. And everyone had their shoes off, and there were also kids there. And my friend plays, like, it's, like, a hardcore band, like, sort of fast power violence type stuff. But one of the bands they played with from Japan was this guy named Death Row, spelled D-E-A-T-H-R-O. And if you've ever, like, watched, like, a Japanese movie or, like, you know, anime, and, like, you know, you just hear that, like, sort of powerful, you know, believe-in-yourself rock music type shit, that's what this guy's playing, just on a DIY level. And it's insane. He's got some song called Evolution, and then another one called Be Myself, back to the English. But just hyper-poppy, catchy shit. So, yeah, go see Horizon, and on your way to and from the theater, listen to my dude, Death Row.
Like, Death Row. It looks like he's screaming into a fan in this Evolution music video, as I'm just seeing, like, the preview of it when you hover over the video.
Hell yeah.
Looks cool. All right, awesome.
Oh, yeah, and then follow me on Twitter at the Towerskin, Instagram, Towerskin Worldwide. I'll be back.
Yeah, you'll be back for sure. We got to...
We got to follow this situation minute to minute.
We got to follow up on this fucking breaking news, man.
Jesus Christ.
All right, and as I always say, oh boy... What I would do if these hands could eat pussy. They removed carcinogenic tumors, separated conjoined twins by the very damned brain itself, clasped themselves in prayer, waited patiently while being painted in a portrait with Jesus H. Christ himself, click-clacked away upon keyboards in order to uncover the secrets of the pyramids being grain silos for the gray aliens, and dutifully jacked myself off through med school and beyond. Now, let's mill around the backstage a bit, like the smacked-out Travolta in Pulp Fiction GIF memes, and have ourselves the best and blurst of times.
And that's the bottom line, because Herman Cain said so.
999.
Worldwide.
Good night. Good luck. Good morning, Vietnam.
Lee Harvey was a friend of mine. I was born in Dallas in 1952. Lee Harvey moved across the street on Beckley Avenue. He used to throw the ball to me when I was just a kid. They say he shot the president. I don't think he did. And Lee Harvey was a friend of mine. He used to take me fishing all the time. He used to throw the ball to me. a kid. They say he shot the president. I don't think he did. I seen that picture of him with pamphlets and a gun. The shadows are pointing every which way, but there's only just one sun. Say he shot the president. I don't think he did. And Lee Harvey was a friend of mine. He used to take me fishing all the time. He used to throw the ball to me when I was just a kid. They say gunned down, murdered by Jack Ruby, the biggest sleaze in town. He stuck that gun into his ribs and said, "Here's looking at you, kid." Ruby killed Lee Harvey. TV proof he did.
And Lee Harvey was a friend.
A very good friend.
He used to take me fishing all the time.
That's right, he did.
He used to throw the ball to me when I was just a kid.
They say he shot the president. I don't think he did.
The first voice recording was made in 1860. It was a 10-second fragment of the French folk song Au clair de la lune recorded by inventor Edward Leon Scott de Martinville. But who will make the final voice recording and when? What will it be? Who will hear it?